let's chat a little bit about how the state is taking away lands that they've been telling us were our land, public land, that in fact never really truly have been. So I'm going to give a couple examples, and the first is in the United States here, the Department of Interior has a Bureau of Land Management. It's a bureaucracy within the larger bureaucracy, and they administer gazillions of acres, especially in the West, of open land. And this land is allegedly for everyone's use. Go out and enjoy it, just don't hurt it, but go out and use it. And I get that there is a, you know, the whole tragedy of the commons thing. And if you're not familiar with that term, I wasn't either until I looked into it. So I suggest you jot it down or remember, go back and kind of look into tragedy of the commons. But the problem is that if you have a lot of land, somebody needs to manage it. Just like if you have a little bit of land, someone needs to manage it. And the people that have been managing it, allegedly, are the Bureau of Land Management. And so they have all these acres of land, and the goal, the global goal of those that are in power are to have human beings and their vehicles, their motor vehicles, move into urban areas and live in cities and stacked into apartments and close to government transportation systems, buses, subways, etc., and to get away from the wild open land and have that be, well, not really nature, because humans are part of nature, so unnaturally non-human is what they would like the open lands to be. And so little by little, the goal is to get people away from those areas, not to build homes there, not to have businesses there, and if people do recreate there, to recreate as they would like you to recreate, or as the powers that be would like us to recreate. They would not like us to use motor vehicles. They're okay for now with us using horses to get there. They're fine with us hiking there, as long as we don't leave any trace that we've been there, which kind of just sounds like, you know, if you're using a friend's property, that's not a bad idea not to hurt the place. Completely good with that. I'm good with the idea of not hurting the places that we go unnecessarily. Being reckless is a bad idea to do that, so I'm good with that. Here's one of the challenges. As they manage this with the ultimate goal of driving the public away from that land and reducing uses, they're doing little tricks like this. They'll go out every couple years and look at a little trailway, a road, ATV road, and they'll look at it and they'll say, yeah, it doesn't look like anybody's been here in a couple years. It's not needed anymore. We're going to shut it down. And they find another one and they do the same thing. And then they look and they say, well, you know, there could be some erosion here at some point, and so we need to shut this road down too. And so every year, huge portions of public land is closed off. These roads are shut for environmental purposes, reclamation purposes, etc. They're not reopened. Very, very few of the places that are shut down to human use are ever reopened. They're turned into wilderness areas. A wilderness area, yeah, can't take your motorcycle or bicycle. You can take a horse, you can go on foot, but you can't go by popular productive means of transport. And whether or not you personally like this or not, like if you like the idea of hiking without hearing a loud motorcycle go by, I get that. But I hope that my principles are similar to yours in that it's not our preferences that we want to enforce on others. It's our principles that we don't want to have others trample upon. So the principle is, if we're all sharing the land, we should all kind of sort of get to use it as long as we're not, you know, messing it up for everybody. Well, that's exactly the argument they'll use. Well, people like to hike here, and you're messing it up for them if you're on an ATV, so you can't be here. So this is just kind of a little rant. That's one example. Here's another example. And here's where the rich folks get on board, and the large property owners like ranchers and farmers and such, which I'm not saying that they're rich, I'm not putting them in the same category, but I live in an affluent area, and people will come into the area and they'll buy a 40-acre property for $10 million that has a nice house on it. And they have to pay property in a very expensive place. They have to pay property taxes on their property. And if they're charged by acre, it can get kind of expensive for residentially zoned property. So there's a scheme that the politicians and the wealthy people have come up with as a solution to the United Nations mandates for sustainability. It's all under Agenda 21. And what they do, which is kind of smart, the wealthy people aren't really catching on to the deep, real, true reasons for this. Neither are the local politicians. I mean, you're not a local politician if you're wise and forward-thinking and, you know, read a lot and are really into history and philosophy and social science and such and anthropology. You're not going to be a local politician. Having said all of these complimentary things, the politicians and the wealthy people have this great little scheme where the politicians get what they want, which is the land never being further developed as future property owners might want it to be. And the current property owner gets what they want, which is lower taxes, lower property taxes. So what they do is they'll say, well, we're only going to build on this 1 acre or these 2 acres. We're going to have our primary house and our guest house, and that's, you know, really all the only buildings we need. So the other 39 acres, we would like to put into a land trust. And this land trust is basically included in the, you know, it's a requirement for future owners, part of the deed, never to build on those 39 acres on the property. Only 1 acre or 2 acres on this whole property can ever be built up. Of course, the county on the side has regulation as to the size of a home that can be placed on that property. So in effect, 39 acres have become government land, public land, protected land, whatever you want to call it. And I might love that idea because I love being out in the wild, in the woods. And it feels like that when you're in some big subdivision with 100 lots of 40 acres each, and 39 out of 40 of those acres are wide open woodland. It's gorgeous. It's wonderful. The problem is that these rich people have been duped by the useful idiots, the local politicians. They don't realize what they're doing. They have been duped into fulfilling these human settlement desires, not requirements. It's a non-binding agreement that the United Nations has. United Nations wants people in human settlements. The more they can get them out of there, out of the open other places and into these human settlements, the happier they're going to be. So the chances of somebody coming and buying one of those 40-acre parcels that has a land trust on it, let's say it didn't have a land trust, those people could now subdivide those 39 other acres and put 100 homes on them or 50 homes on them and thus solve the Western mountain town housing crisis that is happening in so many places, Aspen Vale, Jackson Hole. They could easily solve that. Except the county won't let this happen. They have their bosses up higher that are not letting them make this happen. And they are colluding with the wealthy property owners in this little scheme of theirs. Then they take this same scheme, slightly varied, and they apply it to local ranchers and farmers. These poor folks are just, they've had this plot of land in their family for 75 or 100 or 150 years, and they're not wealthy people. They have a lot of land, but it's not like they can sell it on the open market. The county has it zoned for agriculture or something else, won't let them subdivide it into 5-acre lots and sell one every 5 years to retire on. The county's not going to let that happen. So then the county comes to this family and says, hey, we're taxing you every year. It's getting higher and higher. You can't afford it. We're bankrupting you. You're going to have to sell this property in order to pay taxes on that one last little lot you have. The poor old ranching family says, well, we can't do that. Aren't there any other options? And they say, oh, yes, there are. How about we put in the deed that everybody else that ever owns this land can't do anything productive with it? Can't do anything. They can't build a factory here, a home here, a mobile home park, a dump, a warehouse. Nothing can ever happen to this property that isn't in line with what the sustainability movement wants. And the ranchers are thinking, well, all we ever plan to do is graze our cattle on it. And well, how about if one of our kids ever wants to build a cabin? The county says, you know what, that one residence per 40 acres, you win. We get that and we think that's okay. Sure enough, there it goes. That same plan is now screwing over so many propertied old timers in the Mountain West. It's a horrible thing. I've just shared with you a few things: shutting down ATV trails, wilderness areas, land trusts, and these are all the underhanded, backward ways that human beings are driven away from lands that they thought they had a right to, or that they owned a little portion of, a shared portion of, how they're being driven away from those and into human settlements. It's sad, it's disgusting, and no, it's not binding any more than Hitler telling his people not to like the Jews. It wasn't binding that he said, go break their windows tomorrow. No, it's not a binding agreement. But it happens nonetheless. When the orders come down from the top, it happens. And your local county and city officials are very likely following these same orders, doing this same thing. I can almost guarantee it. If they are not, please be in touch. I would like to move to where it is that you live.